Welcome to worship at Cornerstone Faith Community Church. We are so glad to be worshiping together with you this fourth Sunday in the season of Lent. As we begin our worship time today, will you please stand and join us in a responsive call of worship?
Jesus came to earth for our sake. He walked this earth for us. His journey was far from beautiful. It was filled with mockery, torment, and pain.
We come to this place to worship the one who suffered for us. We come to give honor and praise to the one who bore our pain and carried our sorrows.
The prophet Isaiah told us that even when Jesus was oppressed and afflicted, he remained silent, not because he didn't hurt and not because there wasn't pain. Jesus remained silent because of his willingness to be faithful even unto death.
We come to this place to worship and honor the one who willingly gave up his life for ours. Jesus, our Savior, paid the highest and greatest price, canceling the debt of our sin and lifting the weight of our iniquity. He has set us free.
People of God, let us bless the Lord for his faithfulness to us. In his great love, he has shown us inexpressible mercy and grace. He who deserved punishment have been given reprieve. Your Savior has won for you.
We come to this place to worship Jesus, King of all kings and King of our hearts. Hope springs eternal because our Savior remains faithful.
Well, brothers and sisters, as Isaiah concluded his words regarding the suffering servant, Jesus, our Messiah, he said these words. It was the Lord's will to crush him and to cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. And after he has suffered, he will see the light of life and will be satisfied. And by his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he has poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors.
I should come.
brothers and sisters, let's be in a spirit of prayer this morning. Father, as we come into your house this morning, we are reminded that Jesus is strong for us and he is kind for us. Father, there have been many ways in which our lives this week have not aligned with your will. There have been many ways this week, Father, where we have strayed from what you would have for us. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have not trusted that you indeed are good, faithful, strong, and kind. That's why we're here this morning, Father, to confess our manifold sins before you and to worship you, to stand once again before the awesome and perfect God and be reminded that you love us, you care for us, and you intend to cleanse us from all of our sin. So, Father, hear your people this morning as we confess to you our sin, as we ask once again for your forgiveness, and as we ask, Father, that you would now open our ears, open our eyes, and open our hearts, that we would hear once again the word you have for us this morning. Thank you, Father, for this time. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Well, good morning. And welcome to Cornerstone Faith Community Church. We are so glad that you have gathered with us. This morning as we came into worship, it was looking a little bit like people forgot that we had to change time, but look at you. Well done. Well done. If you are here for worship or for Sunday school this morning, make your way to the back of the sanctuary. Our teachers are ready to meet with you. Let me take a moment to share a few words of announcement with you all, things that are coming up in the life of the church. I do just want to say thank you to everybody who came out for our Saturday morning breakfast study and fellowship yesterday. We had a great time. And just a reminder, that was our last one for the spring, but we did talk as a group yesterday about the possibility of trying one early in the summer and see how it goes. Sometimes summer's a little hit or miss because of vacation schedules, but we're going to try for one maybe in late May or early June. So watch the announcements for that. But it was a great time. Thank you to everybody who did come and join us for that. Coming up the 16th, Saturday the 16th, which I guess is this coming Saturday, isn't it? Yes. This coming Saturday is our movie night. We will meet down in the Welcome Center. We will build our own movie theater. We'll be watching Faith Like Potatoes, which is a great story of overcoming so many different struggles and trials. A South African farmer, potato farmer. I think you'll find the story to be very moving. Don't forget that we will have the concession stand open. We'll have lots of different things for you to purchase from the concession stand, dinner type stuff, hot dogs, nachos, that kind of thing. That starts at 6 p.m. Saturday evening. Please don't forget to bring a chair with you, or if you, for some reason, want to sit on a pretty hard concrete floor, bring a blanket with you, but you're welcome to do that as we build our own movie theater downstairs. No cost for admission to the movie, just the only thing that you would need money for is if you want to purchase something from the concession stand, which we try to keep very, very reasonable. Also, things that are coming up in the life of the church, Holy Week is very, very quickly coming, and so we want to make sure that you are aware of all of the Holy Week opportunities that we have, starting with Palm Sunday, Sunday, March 24th. Palm Sunday will be our annual pancake breakfast starting at 8:30 a.m. We will have pancakes and sausage, fruit, coffee, juice, milk. This is a free will donation breakfast. And yes, we love to get together. We love to eat, obviously. If you've been around, you know that. But friends, the purpose of this is giving you a reason to invite someone. We believe that we need a catalyst for people to come and hear the good news of Jesus at Easter time. And Easter Sunday is oftentimes not a good time to try to have something special like a breakfast because people have so many different plans. And so we've found that Palm Sunday is the better time to do that. So please think about who you might invite to come and join us. This is a great opportunity to share Cornerstone Faith Community Church with someone and say to them, hey, I'll buy you breakfast. It's a free will donation. And so it is just a great opportunity to have friends, neighbors, relatives come and join us. We hope that you will consider who you can bring with you. The breakfast starts at 8:30, and then worship begins at 10 o'clock as normal. We will serve breakfast until 9:30 about, just so that we have enough time to kind of clean up a few things before we come upstairs. That breakfast is being served to you by our administrative council, and so we thank them for their help in that. Then, Good Friday. If you've not been part of our Good Friday experience here, we do things a little bit different than many places, but we have a dramatic experience on Good Friday. And so it is a come and experience kind of service. Worship team has been working hard on special music. There is going to be, I'll be doing a portrayal of Pontius Pilate, a monologue of Pontius Pilate that evening. It is going to be a tenebrae service, a service of darkness and shadows. I believe it is going to be very, very moving. It is, a great opportunity to invite friends and neighbors to hear the truth of what Jesus has done for us and to experience his death on the cross. That's Good Friday, Friday, March 29th. That begins at 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary. And then, of course, our favorite service, the pinnacle moment of Easter, our Easter morning resurrection celebration, not sunrise, resurrection celebration service. That'll take place at 10 o'clock on Easter morning, March 31st, with lots of great music, scripture, and just joyous fellowship celebrating the resurrection of our Savior. So we hope that you will join us for all of those Holy Week services here at Cornerstone Faith Community Church. Of course, those services will be available as well digitally, online. The Good Friday service is not going to be live streamed. It will be recorded and then will be put up to our Facebook page and our YouTube page at a later time. But Easter morning will be live streamed as normal. Let's see, Jeannie, is there anything I'm forgetting? Yes. Wednesday evening Lenten study. Yes, we have our Wednesday evening Lenten study continues, and we have our breakfast for dinner this week. And so we're doing French toast for dinner this week. So please come and join us at 6 p.m. For dinner. If you'd like to join us for dinner, if you want to come just for study, it's at 6:45. Anything else? All right. In your bulletins this morning, you will also find our prayer list. We would ask that you would keep that list handy in a place where you can see it every day and be praying with us throughout the week. Thank you for your prayers for those folks who have been on the list throughout this past week. We trust and know that God has heard those prayers and he is working for the good of those who love him. This morning, would you please join me in a general word of prayer then? Well, Heavenly Father, we do give you thanks and praise this morning that we have this opportunity to come together in your house to give you worship and praise. And Father, we thank you that you have filled your house this morning with hearts that are eager to hear the good news of Jesus. Father, we thank you for such simple things like waking us up and bringing us here this morning, getting us here safely. Father, the ways in which you are good to us each and every day, they are manifold. They continue to astound us. You never fail us, Father. We have so much to be thankful for. And so we begin this morning, Father, by saying thank you. And those two simple words are truly never enough, but they're all the words that we have. Lord, you have blessed us richly. You've provided for us, you've cared for us, and you've loved us. And your word tells us that as we have been faithful to come and bow our knee before you, bow our heads and our hearts before you, and confess our sin before you, you are faithful and just. You forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness. So, Father, we truly have so much to be thankful for. Lord, we come before you, living in a world that is filled with moments we can't explain. There have been incredible things that have happened in our world this week. There have been shootings. There have been terrible disasters of weather. There have been political things that have happened that we don't understand. Father, there have been things in other states. There have been things in other countries. There have been things here in our own backyards that we struggle to make sense of. Yet your word, Father, tells us that difficult times will come. Trials will come. Troubles will come. In fact, your word tells us we should not be surprised when they come, because that's what this world is filled with. And when these moments come, your word calls us to dig deeper, to lean on you more, to trust you even more. So, Father, we ask for the power of your Holy Spirit that we might trust you more in the midst of those difficult moments. When things are confusing, when we struggle to understand them, when we struggle to make sense of them, will you help us by your power? Father, we also lay before you this morning those who are sick, those who have had surgery, those who are about to have surgery, those who have been hospitalized. Father, those who are grieving, those who have great need. Lord, we know that in all things you are working, providing, loving, comforting, caring, and healing. And so, Lord, we continue to lay these before you, trusting and knowing that you hear the prayers of your people and you answer us. Lord, the writer of Hebrews said that we should bring our petitions before you with confidence, that we should approach your throne with confidence. So confidently, Father, we lay these requests before you. And Lord, this morning, we do give you thanks for this place, Cornerstone Faith Community Church, for all who worship and gather here, for this family that you have given to us, for the love and the support that we have in one another. We give you thanks for the leadership of this church, for our administrative council, and for all of the work that they do. And Father, we lay before you those who have not yet walked through our doors, those who you are preparing to bring to us. Would you begin to prepare our hearts to receive them well, that we might boldly share the name of Jesus with them, that we might receive them well, that we might love them well, care for them, and provide for them. And so, Father, we lay all of this before you this morning, knowing and trusting that you've heard us. We give you this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Brothers and sisters, this morning our message series continues as we talk about sackcloth and ashes, and we've talked for 3 weeks about the topic of sin, and today we begin to bridge the gap and make the transition from sin to grace, and we'll do that by talking about confessing sin. And so this song that we're going to sing is our pre-message song this morning. The intention is for this to be a time for us to think about our hearts, to purge our hearts this morning, and to use this song as a sort of prayer of confession together as we sing. So let's sing together. So this morning, the reading that we have is a little bit lengthy. So I'm going to have you guys remain seated for the reading this morning. But I'd ask you to open your hearts and your minds to the reading of God's word this morning, that it would fall fresh on us. As we consider the matter of confessing our sins before God our Father, this morning we read from the prophet Nehemiah, chapter 9, beginning at verse 1. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word for this day. On the 24th day of the same month, the Israelites gathered together, fasting and wearing sackcloth and putting dust on their heads. Those of Israelite descent had separated themselves from all foreigners. They stood in their places and confessed their sins and the sins of their ancestors. They stood where they were and read from the book of the law of the Lord their God for a quarter of the day and spent another quarter in confession and worshiping the Lord their God. Standing on the stairs of the Levites were Jeshua, Benai, Kadmiel, Shebaniah, Bunai, Sherebiah, Benai, and Kenani. They cried out with loud voices to the Lord their God, and the Levites, Jeshua, Kadmiel, Benai, Hashabaniah, Sherebiah, Hodiah, Shebaniah, and Pethahiah said, "Stand up and praise the Lord your God, who is from everlasting to everlasting. Blessed be your glorious name, and may it be exalted above all blessing and praise, for you alone are the Lord. You made the heavens, even the highest heavens and all their starry host, the earth and all that is on it, the seas and all that is in them. You give life to everything, and the multitudes of heaven worship you. You are the Lord God who chose Abram and brought him out of Ur of the Chaldeans, and named him Abraham. You found his heart faithful to you, and you made a covenant with him to give to his descendants the land of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, and the Girgashites. You have kept your promise because you are righteous. You saw the suffering of our ancestors in Egypt, and you heard their cry at the Red Sea. You sent signs and wonders against Pharaoh, against all his officials and all the people of his land, for you knew how arrogant the Egyptians treated them. You made a name for yourself, which remains to this day. You divided the sea before them so that they passed through it on dry ground, but you hurled their pursuers into the depths like a stone into mighty waters. By day, you led them with a pillar of cloud, and by night, a pillar of fire to give them light on the way they were to take. You came down on Mount Sinai. You spoke to them from heaven. You gave them regulations and laws that are just and right, and decrees and commands that are good. You made known to them your holy Sabbath and gave them commands, decrees, and laws through your servant Moses. In their hunger, you gave them bread from heaven, and in their thirst, you brought them water from the rock. You told them, go in and take possession of the land you had sworn with uplifted hand to give them. But they, our ancestors, became arrogant and stiff-necked. They did not obey your commands. They refused to listen and failed to remember the miracles you performed among them. They became stiff-necked and in their rebellion appointed a leader in order to return to their slavery. But you are a forgiving God, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. Therefore, you did not desert them, even when they cast themselves an image of a calf and said, 'This is your God who brought you up out of Egypt,' or when they committed awful blasphemies. Because of your great compassion, you did not abandon them in the wilderness. By day, the pillar of cloud did not fail to guide them on their path, nor the pillar of fire by night to shine on the way they were to take. You gave your good spirit to instruct them. You did not withhold your manna from their mouths, and you gave them water for their thirst. For 40 years, you sustained them in the wilderness. They lacked nothing. Their clothes did not wear out, nor did their feet become swollen. You gave them kingdoms and nations, allotting them even the remotest frontiers. They took over the country of Sihon, king of Heshbon, and the country of Og, the king of Bashan. You made their children as numerous as the stars in the sky, and you brought them into the land that you told their parents to enter and possess. Their children went in and took possession of the land. You subdued before them the Canaanites who lived in the land. You gave the Canaanites into their hands, along with their kings and their peoples of the land, to deal with them as they pleased. They captured and forfeited cities and fertile land. They took possession of houses filled with all kinds of good things, wells already dug, vineyards, olive groves, and fruit trees in abundance. They ate to the full and were well nourished. They reveled in your great goodness. But they were disobedient and rebelled against you. They turned their backs on your law. They killed your prophets who had warned them in order to turn them back to you. They committed awful blasphemies. So you delivered them into the hands of their enemies who oppressed them. But when they were oppressed, they cried out to you. From heaven you heard them. And in your great compassion, you gave them deliverers who rescued them from the hands of their enemies. But as soon as they were at rest, they again did what was evil in your sight. Then you abandoned them to the hand of their enemies so that they ruled over them. And when they cried out to you again, you heard from heaven, and in your compassion, you delivered them time after time. You warned them in order to turn them back to your law, but they became arrogant and disobeyed your commands. They sinned against your ordinances, of which you said the person who obeys them will live by them. Stubbornly, they turned their backs on you, became stiff-necked, and refused to listen. For many years, you were patient with them. By your spirit, you warned them through your prophets, yet they paid no attention. So you gave them into the hands of the neighboring peoples. But in your great mercy, you did not put an end to them or abandon them, for you are a gracious and merciful God. Now, therefore, our God, the great, mighty, and awesome, who keeps his covenant of love, do not let all this hardship seem trifling in your eyes. The hardship that has come on us, our kings and our leaders and our priests and our prophets, on our ancestors and all your people from the days of the kings of Assyria until today. In all that has happened to us, you have remained righteous. You have acted faithfully while we acted wickedly. Our kings, our leaders, our priests, our ancestors did not follow your law. They did not pay attention to your commands or to the statutes you warned them to keep. Even while they were in your kingdom, enjoying your great goodness to them in the spacious and fertile land you gave them, they did not serve you or turn from their evil ways. But see, we are slaves today. Slaves in the land you gave our ancestors so they could eat its fruit and the other good things it produces. Because of our sins, its abundant harvest goes to the kings you have placed over us. They rule over our bodies and our cattle as they please. We are in great distress. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Brothers and sisters, there is truly something incredible that happens when God's people get together. It's interesting how our Sunday morning gatherings can so easily become routine and repetitive. Some people might even say mundane. And it happens so quickly and so easily. I mean, just think about it. It was but a mere 2 years ago that we were all saying to each other, you know, I would give anything for life to be back to normal. With regular Sunday morning gatherings every week like we had before COVID struck. Well, brothers and sisters, here we are. Life is, for the most part, back to normal. We have our regular Sunday gatherings back, and for the most part, things are operating as they were pre-COVID. But then just last week, I happened to be involved in three different conversations at three different times with folks from this very church family. All three of those conversations centered around one same topic: complacency, a lack of focus, a loss of vision. In fact, all three of those conversations had a comment similar to this in them. Sometimes we need to remind ourselves why we are here, what our purpose is as a church family, and that what happens on Sunday morning is supposed to be about furthering the gospel, not our own personal agendas. So, brothers and sisters, how do we go from "I'd give anything to get back to regular Sunday morning gatherings" to needing to remind ourselves what our purpose is on Sunday morning so quickly? I think there is a pretty simple explanation for that. We so easily take for granted the joy, the blessing, the privilege that we have in the opportunity of the Sunday gathering. We easily take for granted, by the way, not just the Sunday gathering, but the joy and the blessing and the privilege we have in the Wednesday evening gatherings and the Saturday morning breakfast study gatherings and every other opportunity we have to get together as the people of God. Now, my purpose this morning, by the way, is not to beat you down about your attitude about coming to church or coming to Wednesday night study or whatever it is. Could we have a better attitude about those things sometimes? Absolutely, we could. Do we all lose our focus? Do we all forget sometimes what our actual purpose is when we are here in worship? Yes, we all do. We're human. But I bring this up to you because it fits perfectly with the text that we have just read, the situation that was unfolding for Israel in Nehemiah. You see, Israel was having much the same problem that we are experiencing. They had forgotten purpose. They had forgotten what it was that God had brought them up out of Egypt, up out of the hands of slavery and the persecution of Egypt, delivered them into their own land, a land flowing with milk and honey. They had forgotten why God did that. They had so easily forgotten that it was God who had given them life. It was God who had given them breath. It was God who had seen their suffering, God who had heard them crying, and it was God who had rescued them. They had forgotten it was God who had come down on Mount Sinai, spoken to them from heaven, given them commands, decrees. They had forgotten it was God who had given them manna from heaven, bread that came down and laid on the ground for them. And they had forgotten that it was God who had broken that rock and given them water for their thirst. Nehemiah, the prophet of the Lord, was called into the ministry for the Lord in the days just after the people of God had returned home from captivity, exile in Babylon. Ezra, who served as the prophet right before Nehemiah, he had been charged with bringing a sense of urgency about spiritual reform for the people. Ezra's message was this. Ezra said, "Hey, people, wake up. We got to start getting real about our sin. We got to start to make some real changes. Hey, where have you heard that before?" Now, Nehemiah's charge from God is a little bit different. He picks up where Ezra leaves off, but his task was more practical. Nehemiah's message was this. He says, if we're going to get past all of this sin, if we're going to get behind these times, we've got to move into a deeper, better relationship with God. And more importantly, we've got to move into a deeper, better relationship with one another. We've got to learn how to support one another. Nehemiah says this. He says, it's going to take all of us working together and supporting each other if we're really going to make change in our lives when it comes to our sin. So it makes perfect sense that as we open up chapter 9 of Nehemiah's record this morning, the first thing we read was this. On the 24th day of the same month, the Israelites gathered together, fasting and wearing sackcloth and putting dust on their heads. Those of Israelite descent had separated themselves from the foreigners. They stood in their places. They confessed their sins and the sins of their ancestors. They stood where they were and read from the book of the law of the Lord their God for a quarter of the day. And they spent another quarter in confession and worshiping the Lord their God. Now the people of God came together for a united purpose. They were going to, for once and for all, finally get real about that which stood between them and their God. And in order to do that, I want you to notice, they spent a quarter of the day reading from the book of the law, reminding themselves of what God had commanded them, had asked of them. And then they spent another quarter of the day confessing their sins and worshiping their God. Now, I want to be sure that you understand what that means. They spent no less than 6 hours. Y'all want to check your watches? 6 hours. Reading God's word together aloud. And then if that wasn't enough, they spent another 6 hours. And did you catch this? Standing in the presence of the Lord, worshiping. Now, if my math skills haven't failed me, that's a 12-hour church service, folks. Who's ready? More importantly than the amount of time that Israel spent was what Israel was doing in that time. They were reading and studying God's word. They were being reminded of all that God had commanded them and demanded from them. In fact, it is entirely right to say that they were being reminded of all that God expected of them and everything that they were too preoccupied, too busy to be concerned with. As Israel read those words, they were being convicted. They were being reminded that these were the commands of God, but they had not obeyed them. These were the covenants that they had made with God, but they had not kept them. Even still, in that moment, God's word was doing exactly what God's word is intended to do. Do you know that one of the intended uses of God's law is to function as a mirror? One of the intended uses of God's law is to function as a mirror. God's law is intended to reveal to us our sin. God's word is intended to convict us of our sin. James, the half-brother of Jesus, he wrote about this very topic in his letter to the church. James chapter 3 says this, "Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. You have to actually do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do." James chapter 3, 22 through 25. Friends, in the 1980s, now some of you are going to really remember this and you're going to chuckle, but in the 1980s, one of the most popular home fashions was mirrors. Mirrors everywhere. Even today, you can sometimes walk into a home that has not been updated recently. You can find closet doors that are nothing but mirror panels. You can find accent walls that are nothing but mirror panels. You can even find bedroom furniture, side tables, coffee tabletops, nothing but mirrors. What was it that caused the fad of mirrors, mirrors everywhere to go out of style? Oh, get this. Believe it or not, people aren't so fond of seeing themselves everywhere they walk in their house. You see, that's the problem with mirrors. They tend not to lie. I mean, unless we're talking about those mirrors that are made to be all kinds of funny shapes when you go to the fun house at the carnival, a mirror, if it's any kind of mirror, it is intended not to lie to you. It literally only shows you what is being shown to it. A well-renowned Lutheran theologian by the name of Philip Melanchthon, he is officially credited with having coined the idea that God's law has three uses. Now, down through the ages, Melanchthon's idea has been translated into various different theological viewpoints, but each of them finds the same basic conclusion. When we come to God's word, especially when we come to God's law, his commands and his decrees, for our lives, it has three basic functions. First, as a curb to keep us on the righteous path. Secondly, as a guide to lead us in the righteous way. And then thirdly, as a mirror to show us our sinfulness, that we might turn from it and once again live the righteous life. When Israel came together that day that Nehemiah was recording for us in our text for today, they were definitely in need of a curb, something to help keep them on the righteous path. They were in need of a guide, someone who would lead them so that they would not again go astray from God's word. But here's the problem. What good is having the curb or the guide if they didn't first know that they weren't walking the right path? In other words, what good is it to say that God's word is intended to keep us from sinning or to lead us in the way that is not sin if we haven't first recognized that when we are left to our own devices, we will sin? Israel needed desperately to be shown that they had chosen sin. So God gathered them together for that express purpose. 6 hours. The eyes of the people were opened. They came to understand the error of their way. It must have been quite something to watch that unfold. Can you imagine being in the midst of the people of God as simultaneously together all at once they came to the understanding that they had sinned? What a weight must have been laid upon them. What a heavy load that must have been to carry for them. Even still, I want you to fear not, brothers and sisters, because in the midst of that difficult moment, while Israel was being reminded of all that God had commanded from them and everything that they had overlooked and everything that they had forgotten to do and everything that they had refused to do, in that moment, they were being reminded, hey, while you were doing all that sinning, God still saw you through the desert. God had seen him through the desert, through the deep waters, brought them out of slavery, rescued him from the hand of the enemy. And all while they were still busily sinning, God didn't leave his people with the pain of guilt and shame. He didn't condemn them and walk away. Instead, in the moment, in the midst of their deep distress, in the midst of that heavy burden, he moved within the people a spirit of confession and worship. The Levites, the priests of the people, they remembered all that God had done for the people. And they stood up right there in the midst of that terrible moment. And this is what they proclaimed. Stand up, O people of God, and praise the Lord your God, who is from everlasting to everlasting. To me, that's a strange thing for somebody to say when they've just been confronted with the number of sins in their life. Stand up and praise the God who is from everlasting to everlasting. What a strange and perfectly appropriate thing to say. For God was no less long-suffering, no less merciful, no less full of love and grace on that day as he is today. And so, just like Israel, we also need to be reminded. We need to be reminded that confessing our sin demonstrates our trust. Our trust in the faithfulness of God. We should be willing. In fact, we should be eager to confess our sins to God because he has always been faithful. He has always been just. He has always been good. And so this morning, I want to give you three quick reminders. Three quick reminders that should encourage you to want to confess your sin. Here's the first one. As Israel rehearsed the past sins of their ancestors, they were reminded that grace blossoms in the soil of painful experiences. Grace blossoms in the soil of painful experiences. As Jesus was teaching his disciples about the word of God, he used a parable that we call the parable of the sower of the seeds. In Luke chapter 8, we hear this. It says, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along a path. It was trampled on, then the birds ate it up. Some fell on rocky ground. When it came up, the plants withered because they had no moisture. Other seed fell among the thorns. They grew up, and the plants were choked out. Still other seed fell on good soil. It came up, and it yielded a crop, 100 times more than what was sown. Now, perhaps what is most interesting about this parable is the fact that the seed grows no matter where it's sown. We see the seed falls on rocky ground and it still germinates and it grows. The seed sown in the thorny ground, it germinates and it grows. Now, sure, when it comes up in the rocky ground, it can't survive because it hasn't got soil, it hasn't got a foundation. When it comes up in the thorny ground, it can't survive. The thorns choke it out. But ultimately, it grows. Now, Jesus' point in this parable is that in order for God's word to take root and grow, it has to have good soil. So the seed that was sown in the good soil, it grows and it flourishes. But I can't help but notice that God's word still germinates in all of those other bad soil places. And I think it's important for us to think about that when we think about God's grace. You don't have to be a perfect Christian in order to experience the benefit of God's grace. Did you guys hear that? You don't have to be a perfect Christian in order to benefit from God's grace. As a matter of fact, I would suggest that grace is most vividly, most profoundly experienced in the moments when we are acting least like a Christian. Grace blossoms, brothers and sisters, perhaps especially in the soil of painful experiences. Let's not forget that this moment that Nehemiah is recording for us, this moment of worship and praise, remembering all that God has said, all that God has done for his people, this powerful moment comes just as God's people have come back from 72 years in exile in Babylon. They have been slaves to a dictator. Their entire nation has been destroyed. More than 3/4 of their entire population has died. But amid all of that, grace blossoms. Israel's back home. God has seen them through this trial. Better days lie ahead. Right there in the midst of that trial, that painful experience, grace blossoms. Second reason that we should be encouraged to confess our sin. Verse 18 of our text reminds us that God heard his people from heaven and he delivered them in his compassion over and over again. So God offers us grace upon grace because we are so quick to forget. Over and over again in his word, God calls his people stiff-necked. He used that term 3 times in our text for today alone. The idea of being stiff-necked is a strange one, for on one hand, it actually could maybe be a good thing to be stiff-necked. Here's why. If only we could use that stiff-neckedness for our good. You see, the term suggests that you're stuck on one way of thinking, so entirely focused on one way of thinking. Now, if we could use that to be so focused on God, that would be great, but the term doesn't suggest that. It means that we are so focused on our way of thinking, our ideas, that we are unwilling to consider anything else. In other words, we're literally so stubborn that we can't move our neck. We won't be moved. It could be a thing if we were stiff-necked for God, but that's not what stiff-necked means. When Israel was stiff-necked, they were so set in their obstinate, far from God ways that they would not be bothered to turn their heads to the left or to the right long enough to notice that they had strayed from the only one who ever loved them and cared for them. Unfortunately, you and I do the same thing. Time and time again, we are so focused on other things, on ourselves, on people, on the things of this world, on the media, that we lose sight of God. And frankly, brothers and sisters, if we simply lost track of God or lost sight of him, well, that would be, I suppose, one thing. But being truly stiff-necked towards him. You see, being stiff-necked towards God means that we're saying, hey, God, my way's better. Hey, God, my way's a lot more comfortable for me, so I'm good. And that's when sin enters the picture. Over and over again. Every week, every hour, every day. Now, some people ask how creatures so intelligent as us can be so easily distracted. How can we so easily forget the need for God? There are simple answers to that question. Here, you ready for them? Pride. Peer pressure, entitlement, laziness, greed, the list goes on and on. And that's the bad news. We do forget God sometimes, a lot of the times, more often than we would like to admit it. We turn to sin rather than standing firm and fast in him. And so we find that once again, we have something that we need to confess. We find ourselves before the holy and awesome God, pleading once again for him to look past our stiff-neckedness. But here's the good news. Verses 17 and 18, they remind us that God didn't desert Israel even though they were stiff-necked. Not even, by the way, when they cast a golden calf image and they worshiped it and said, hey, this golden calf is what brought us out of Egypt. Not even with all other kinds of blasphemies. And so there's the good news. Our necks can never be so stiff that they are stiffer than God's grace is strong. Here's the last reason I want to encourage you to confess your sin this morning. God warns us, hoping we will turn back to him. When we remain stubborn, he remains patient, because he always remains gracious and merciful. A final but no less important reminder that God expects our confession of sin is the simple fact that he continues to warn us against the act of sinning. He continues to remind us what is good for us and what is not, even though he knows that we so easily forget and are stubborn as mules. In our stubborn moments, however, God does not become irritated and impatient. Instead, he is just the opposite. He remains patient with us. He remains full of grace. He remains full of mercy. Nehemiah reminded the Israelites that God didn't leave them out in the wilderness. He didn't leave them all on their own. He didn't leave them to suffer and die. Instead, one of the greatest acts of painstaking patience was when God waited on his people every single day, walking ahead of them, step by step, ever so patiently. He met them with a pillar of smoke in the day and a pillar of fire at night. And for 40 long years, he patiently walked with them through the desert. Now, Nehemiah says if this wasn't enough, God spent centuries warning his people through the words of his prophet. He warned them. He said, turn away from your sin. Turn back to me. But every time God spoke, his people disobeyed him. Even still, God didn't turn away from them. He remained patient with them, faithful to them. The people, they lived in their own kingdom. They paid attention only to themselves. Yet God never broke his covenant of love with them. Why? Because he is long-suffering. Because his love is greater than our disobedience could ever be. Because God doesn't tire of waiting for his children to come home. 2 Peter 3:9 says, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. So earlier this week, I had those conversations with folks about how our Sunday morning series and our Wednesday evening series are focused on the topic of sin. You remember when we started this series and I said, I think I'm crazy. We're spending 6 weeks talking about sin. I'm not even going to have a congregation left by the time we're done. I said to those folks as we talked about these two series on sin, I said, here's my perspective. If you were going to go to the doctor right now and you show up at the doctor's office and he says, hey, here's a cast for your arm. And you go, okay, great, wonderful. And you leave the doctor's office, right? That's one thing. Now, let's say you go to the doctor's office. You say, doctor, my arm is killing me. I can't hardly move it. And he goes, oh, hey, I got something that'll fix that. Here's a cast for your arm. It makes no sense to go to the doctor's office and just randomly put a cast on your arm if you don't understand the need for the cast. The same thing is true when it comes to our sin. The remedy makes no sense without first knowing the ailment. What good is it to proclaim to you the forgiveness of God, to encourage you to speak to people the forgiveness of God, if we have not first made certain that we fully understand the reason why we need forgiveness? Forgiveness means nothing without first understanding sin. So I want to say this. Hopefully these last 3 or 4 weeks have helped you better understand sin. Or as I said in week one, maybe these last 3 weeks have helped you to better take your sin seriously. If that's the case, then I want you to remind you that the next most important step is for you to be reminded that it is equally important for you to confess that sin. You must bring it to the Lord. I believe that means you must speak it to him. You must speak it out of your heart. You must speak it with your lips, in your mind. You must speak your sin to him. You must confess your sin. The Apostle John reminds us that when you confess your sin, then he can be faithful and just to forgive you your sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Why is this so important? Because our lives are painful experiences, troubled moments. But that is the perfect soil for God's grace to grow in. Why is it so important for us to confess our sin? Because God offers us grace upon grace because he knows we forget. Why is it so important for us to confess our sin? Because we are obstinate, stubborn, and stiff-necked. But God remains patient with us. Gracious and full of mercy. So brothers and sisters, let's remember our purpose on Sunday morning. Let's remember our purpose on Wednesday evening, on Saturday morning, on Tuesday afternoon at work. Let's confess our sins to God our Father that we might together as the people of God benefit from his grace and his mercy. Amen? Amen. Father, thank you for this reminder of the need for our confession. Lord, we do pray that you will cause us to fall on our knees before you, to pour out our hearts before you, to confess our sins before you. Lord, I believe there is no greater assurance, there is no better reason for us to confess our sins to you than for the simple fact that it gives you, it provides you the opportunity to be faithful and just to us. That when we confess our sin, you have the opportunity to give us your grace, which we so desperately need, Father. So, Lord, will you help your grace to blossom in the terrible soil of our lives? Because, Father, we desperately need you. We desperately need to be cleansed by you. We cannot do this on our own. So, Father, come now. Hear us as we pray and confess our sin to you. And now hear us as we worship and praise your name. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Will you please stand and sing with us?
To pass.
Well, brothers and sisters, if we follow the pattern of Israel this morning, we have come together in the house of the Lord. We have confessed our sin. All that is left for us to do now is, as Nehemiah said, stand up and praise the name of the Lord of our God, who is from everlasting to everlasting. You see, brothers and sisters, the beauty of confession is that it helps us to get the sin behind us so that we can focus on praise. So will you confess your sin each and every day so you can get that sin behind you and focus on praise? Go, brothers and sisters, with the love of God our Father, the grace and mercy of Jesus Christ, and the power and presence of the Holy Spirit to be yours, so that in the midst of your difficult soil, God's grace can blossom. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Have a wonderful week, everybody.